Okay, guys, one more lecture for Unit 5 and more continuation with how we use land. And we're going to talk today specifically about forestry. So let's talk about our different forms of forestry. We're going to go ahead and open up our PowerPoint, maybe. Again, maybe. There we go. Okay. So forestry, and we'll specifically talk about clear cutting, and we'll talk about sustainable forestry. So first of all, when we talk about a forest, what we're talking about is not gum, but a land that is dominated by trees and other woody vegetation, frequently used for logging as well as for lots of different recreational purposes. So when we talk about commercial timber operations, 73% of commercial timber operations are privately owned, and they are allowed to harvest from publicly owned land in exchange for a royalty that is a percentage of revenues. The government spends more money, just as with our Bureau of Land Management and grazing, the government spends much more money on management than it receives in royalties. So just like grazing, logging is subsidized by the taxpayers. So let's talk about some of the different timber harvest practices. So the first one is the one that we're probably all most familiar with, and that's clear cutting. And when we do clear cutting, that means that you cut almost all or all of the trees in a particular area, leaving behind brush and scrub and some unusable portions, but basically taking down everything in a particular area. So once you clear cut, then we have secondary succession, the establishment of a new set of trees. Those are taken care of, usually tended. And then once they reach maturity, then they're clear cut again. So this form of forestry is the easiest form of forestry. It is usually the most economical. Most of the time, these stands are replanted. And this particular picture, you're looking at a stand that has been replanted. You can see that each of these trees is the same species. So this is a Douglas fir. This is after 4 years. So you can see little tiny fir trees there. So those are the benefits. Some of the adverse effects, well, mostly environmentally. There is a reduction in biodiversity because you have, especially if it's replanted with one particular species, you're not going to have the variety of primary producers, which means that you're not going to have a variety of consumers either. Your fast-growing direct sunlight species are going to be favored when it's replanted. Another adverse effect is that a lot of the species that may have been harvested might not have been usable. They might not have been the valuable species that were desired, but it's just easier to cut it all down, just like bycatch when we talk about fishing using nets. Obviously, lots of habitat destruction. Sometimes we talk about fragmentation, particularly when it comes to building. You have to build roads in order to get to the areas that are being logged. And when you build roads, then you fragment habitat. Anytime we take down large stands of vegetation, that's going to increase wind erosion. You're also going to therefore lose soil nutrients from that topsoil that's blown away. Because that soil is eroding, it's going to wind up in streams. That sediment is going to wind up causing turbidity issues and decreasing the clarity of water. And it does create an environment where mudslides are very possible. Without the shading effect of the trees, both soil and water temperatures tend to increase, which is not good for a lot of aquatic species that like cool water temperatures. Of course, because the carbon dioxide that was being absorbed by the trees is no longer being absorbed, that's going to increase carbon dioxide levels. And this is what it looks like. You can see that we've had a mudslide here. You can see that there's a lot of erosion, wind-based erosion. That's why you're seeing the dust in this picture. And this is clearly a very muddy and sedimented stream. So those are the results of clear cutting. Let's talk about a different timber practice, and that's the practice of planting something called tree plantations. So tree plantations is like farming for trees. So it's clear cut and then it's replanted, usually with single species. They tend to be fast growing species. So generally speaking, this is going to be your pines, not hardwoods. These are never going to mature into diverse ecosystems. And because they are clear cut and replanted with the same species, it's not a crop rotation. So you're going to wind up with significant nutrient depletion of the soil. This is a form of clear cutting. Okay, so our second form of forestry is what we call selective cutting. So in selective cutting, you cut only certain trees, not all of the trees, just some of them. Maybe half, maybe less than half, maybe slightly more than half, but you leave some of the trees and you grow new young seedlings next to those old growth trees. This is going to encourage the growth of shade tolerant species. So this is actually going to encourage hardwoods more than pines. It is also going to prevent a lot of those issues with erosion and biodiversity that you have when you clear cut. However, you're still going to have some habitat loss and certainly some habitat fragmentation, just like we had with clear cutting. And then, of course, we have ecologically sustainable forestry. And we're going to come back to this, but in general, when we talk about ecologically sustainable forestry, we want to make sure that we are maintaining biodiversity. It's very difficult to compete with mechanized practices because in order to not create roads, not to fragment habitat, not to compact soil by using heavy machinery, you're using a lot more labor. For example, even using horses to pull the logs and reduce the soil compaction. So we'll come back to this. Logging conflicts are probably one of the best known environmental conflicts. They're a long-standing conflict because it basically pits timber production against maintaining biodiversity. One of the example is the marbled murrelet. It nests only in old growth coastal redwood forests. So when we cut down redwood forests, we destroy its entire habitat. It is a specialist, so it can't go anywhere else. In the same way, the northern spotted owl lives only in old growth coniferous forests, not redwood forests, but other conifers, other pine trees. Less than 10% of the population of the northern spotted owl is remaining. It lives in the Pacific Northwest and Alaska. In 1991, a court stopped logging in an area of forest in order to protect the owl habitat due to acts to portions of the Endangered Species Act. The projections were that 30,000 to 168,000 logging jobs were going to be lost, and therefore the timber industry seized on this as an example of environmental excesses. Most of those jobs were already being lost because of a decline in old growth forests or because of the advent of mechanization, which was reducing the number of jobs to be had in logging. The northern spotted owl is known as an indicator species. So it is an indicator of the overall health of the forest. And that's one of the reasons that environmentalists were fighting so hard to protect it. So what regulations govern forestry? Since 1982, the U.S. Forest Service has been required to provide habitat for plant and animal communities while meeting multiple use goals. So much like the Bureau of Land Management is charged with managing rangelands without being given guidelines or specifications, the U.S. Forest Service is charged with maintaining forests, but not really given any specifications of how that should be achieved or quantified. So we've talked about Bureau of Land Management manages rangelands. The U.S. Forest Service manages all of our forest lands. So let's talk about sustainable forestry. So we've talked about traditional forestry. Let's talk about sustainable forestry. Sustainable forestry is incredibly important because forests really are key to global sustainability. the wood we need to build with, fiber that we use for paper and for other products, fuel for much of the developing world. Even some of our food products come from forests. And of course, we know that they provide hundreds, if not thousands, of ecosystem services. So if we want to be able to meet all of those demands, we have to maintain our forests sustainably. We have to manage them so that they can be used to meet lots and lots of different needs. So what are the benefits of sustainably managing our forests? Well, obviously there are economic benefits to sustainably managing our forests. They provide jobs for 14 million people. And forests directly affect the livelihoods of 20% of the world's population. That's 1.6 billion people. It's more than that now. They provide products, they provide energy, they store carbon, they help to provide biodiversity. 80% of our species live in forests. And then of course they provide lots of water ecosystem services, from transpiration to protecting watersheds. So how can we mitigate deforestation? We have a couple of approaches that we can take to mitigate deforestation. We can reforest, so that means replanting. We want to make sure that if we are buying wood or using wood, we want to use wood that is harvested by ecologically sustainable forestry techniques. So selective harvesting is a big piece of that. And then when possible, we want to reuse wood. We want to protect our forests from disease. We can do that through integrated pest management systems, just like we can with farming. So monitoring, putting in cultural barriers, physical barriers, biological, and where necessary, chemical. Often with forest management, it results in the removal of affected trees so before they can pass a disease or an infestation onto neighboring trees. And then the unique challenge that forests face is wildfire. And so fire management is one of the areas of environmental management that has changed dramatically in the last probably 20 to 30, well, I guess at this point, 40 years. Fire is a natural process. It occurs through lightning strikes, and it is needed in a lot of forests. It provides nutrient cycling because when we have dead biomass, there's just not enough decomposers in order to liberate those nutrients back into the soil. Burning it breaks it down much faster and allows those nutrients to re-enter the soil. It also provides openings for early succession species. When we have a mature forest and it burns, that opens up the tree canopy and allows those plants that need more light or those seedlings that need more light to grow. There are even some species of trees, the longleaf pine is one that comes to mind, that actually need fire in order to regenerate because the pine cone from that tree doesn't open until subjected to heat. And so the seeds can't escape in order to enter the soil and grow without fire. So it used to be that our approach to fire management on public land was to prevent all wildfires and to suppress all wildfires as quickly as possible. And what we have learned in the last 40 to 50 years is that because fire is a natural process, that we need to manage fire rather than suppressing fire. So a big piece of the Forest Service toolkit is prescribed burns. And a prescribed burn is a small controlled burn so that there is less dead biomass there to fuel large wildfires. And this really changed dramatically after the fires in 1988 that burned over a third of Yellowstone National Park. And so our approach to wildfire management or to forest management has changed with the advent of prescribed burns. And as our climate changes, this is going to become ever more important. This graphic just shows the number and intensity of wildfires in California. So as heat and drought become more common and more prolonged, so too the fire season becomes more common, more prolonged, and each individual fire becomes more intense. At the same time, our population is expanding and our population is moving outward from the cities, which means that there's increased development in areas where wildfires are likely. And so not only are the wildfires becoming more common, they're also threatening developed areas more often. So that's what we need to know about forests. If you have questions, as always, let me know.